Standing some 60 metres above sea level, Operation Chastise of May 1943 owes a debt to this historic place. But where is this striking building and what is its significance? Find out in just a moment. Today's search is about big changes as our buyers ditch the busy capital in search of isolation.
I'm seeing a house here and I'm seeing a house up there.
Sue, it's got a rope swing over a stream.
But later on, disappointment turns to jubilation.
This is everything that I would have drawn in a picture.
This is a different Sue. I like this Sue.
Today we're in Somerset, on the stunning coastline at Breendown Fort, which during World War II was a base for the Department of Miscellaneous Experimental Weapons, where they tested the bouncing bomb for the famous Dambusters raid. This prominent position has commanded the coastline for centuries, although the fort that you see here today was built in the 1860s to protect the coastline from the threat of invasion. And in a strange twist of fate, today, in turn, it's now protected by the National Trust and is also a site of special scientific interest due to its outstanding natural beauty. Somerset sits in the heart of England's West Country. From the heather-clad moorland and dramatic sea cliffs of Exmoor National Park to the low-lying levels and the wooded valleys of the Quantock Hills, it's a county of varying landscapes and is renowned for its dairy and fruit production. The compact Quantocks are just 12 miles long and 4 miles wide. From the coastline on a clear day, views reach across the Bristol Channel as far as the Welsh coast. The county is home to England's smallest city, Wells, which was granted city status due to its 13th century cathedral. Its magnificent west front features over 300 statues and carvings. Further north, just outside the county in North Bristol, the Clifton Observatory and Camera Obscura sit high up on the downs. The Grade II listed building started life as a windmill for corn in the 18th century, and today is a popular spot to enjoy the views of the Clifton Suspension Bridge and Avon Gorge below. From its historic cities with beautiful buildings to its expanses of unspoilt countryside, this county of contrasts offers something for everyone looking to experience its landscape. When it comes to setting up home in Somerset, the average price of a detached house in the county comes in at around £315,000, which is only around £1,500 more than the UK average. But in North Somerset, you can expect to pay around £50,000 more due to its close proximity to the busy hubs of Bath and Bristol. However, travel south or west and you'll be rewarded by not only cheaper house prices, but also swathes of idyllic countryside, which is exactly what's drawing today's buyers to this beautiful county. Sue and Steve met 10 years ago through a chance encounter at Sue's workplace.
I was working at Hampton Court Palace and Steve came in as a visitor and it was love at first sight.
Sue was working in the audio guide office and had a terrible cold, had a very red nose and spoke in a very sort of stuffy voice, which was quite comical. And I made a funny comment about how she sounded and bang, she just came back with a comment straight back at me. And I just thought, wow, this girl's really great. Obviously quite attractive, apart from the big red nose at the time.
Sue moved into Steve's home of 17 years, a four-bedroom 1950s house in Sunbury-on-Thames, Surrey, where he had brought up his two children from a former marriage. So, despite tying the knot 4 years ago, they're still yet to buy their first property together.
This house has been lovely, and it's given everything that we have needed for the last 10 years. I'm very excited about buying our first home together and putting our own stamp on it.
It's only fair that we have a house that you have a big say in that is going to be ours, mm-hmm. ours alone.
As they are both recently retired and their children have grown up, they no longer have ties to London.
We've been looking in Somerset for property and that gives us an ideal spot, be rural, but still near enough for the kids to come down at the weekends and things.
Steve and Sue hope their next home will be the perfect place for visiting grandchildren and those all-important family Christmases. But it also needs to allow them to enjoy their hobbies when it's just the two of them.
I'm very domesticated. I love to cook. Steve and I both like to write. We both read avidly when we're on holiday. It's so easy to get through a book a day. And we both like to paint.
We've got a garage at the bottom of the garden, which I've turned into a workshop, and I just make stuff. My woodwork teacher told me I was useless at woodwork and should never be let near lumber. And I think I just spent my life trying to prove him wrong.
With a house on the market, Steve and Sue are ready for their new adventure and can't wait to, quite literally, get away from it all.
We have no fears about being in an isolated area at all. That is very attractive, actually. So I'm looking forward to be able to look out of a window and perhaps see a neighbour in the distance. That sounds quite pleasant to me.
On his tractor.
On his tractor.
Steve and Sue have chosen Somerset due to its good links to their children and to London. I know where we're looking, now I just need to find out what kind of property we're looking for.
Steve and Sue, welcome to Somerset.
Thank you very much.
You're moving all the way from Sunbury-on-Thames. I mean, it's a lovely part of the world.
It is.
Why are you looking to move from there, then?
We want to get away from traffic. I want to be somewhere where two or three cars gathered together constitutes a traffic jam.
Well, that's the countryside, isn't it?
Exactly.
We have got four children and we've been bringing them up and now the last one has just flown the nest and so it's time for us to find somewhere for ourselves, but somewhere big enough for them all to come down often.
Right, so sounds like we're looking at a 4 to 5 bedroom house then.
Well, 4 would be fine.
Yeah?
4 would be fine.
Yeah. We're looking for somewhere detached. We don't want to be overlooked. We don't want to overlook anywhere. A bit of land between 1 and 4 acres, 2 would be ideal.
What about the style of the house then?
It's probably Victorian, Edwardian, old farmhouse, something like that.
You want a particularly large kitchen, don't you?
I do.
Hub of the house.
What about its location? Because you're talking about aspirations for land, getting away from traffic.
Mm-hmm.
Are you the guy that wants to be in the middle of nowhere?
I'd be very happy in the middle of nowhere.
Is that a dream you both share, Sue?
Oh, for sure. Yeah, absolutely.
How much work can you foresee yourself doing to a property, if at all?
I anticipate putting a new kitchen in somewhere just because I want my perfect kitchen.
Yeah.
Right.
We don't really want major structural work. Mm-hmm.
How much have you got in your piggy bank for this big move of yours?
£650,000.
Right.
If there's something very special, something really nice,
yeah,
up to £700,000.
All right. So you're looking forward to these next couple of days, then?
I'm really excited about it.
Yes, we are.
Let's start. Let's go.
Let's do it.
So Steve and Sue have got a healthy budget of £700,000 to spend here in Somerset. For that, they'd like a detached house with 4 or more bedrooms and a generously sized kitchen. Last but not least, they want to be in an isolated rural location. We've got 3 cracking properties ready for them to see, all with heaps of character and the potential for them to create their rural dream. At each one, they'll have to guess the price before I reveal it, and to finish off, I'll be showing them a mystery house in a location that will really test their boundaries. For our first property, we're heading to the village of Spaxton. Set in the Quantock Hills, this area of outstanding natural beauty is known for its great walking terrain and riding trails. The main part of this quiet, sprawling village surrounds St Margaret's Parish Church. There's a local shop and a village hall where twice a year residents exhibit locally grown produce, flowers and crafts at the village show. Situated on the outskirts of the village, I'm hoping our first property could provide Steve and Sue with that rural existence they're looking for.
Now, I'd like us to stop here. I think this is the best vantage point to take everything in, not just the house, but to see snippets of what's on offer.
I like it.
Do you?
Yes.
Good.
From the outside, I'm sure it's very pretty as you get closer, but I'm suspecting it's too pretty.
Ah, OK. Well, it is very cutesy, isn't it?
It is
very
cutesy.
Cottagey.
I like this.
You're going to love
it's
that when you go down there. Yeah, that's exactly it. You've got topography here, Stephen.
Topography.
My favourite
yes.
word.
Yeah. It has. It's got interest and shape and height.
It's certainly got an interesting variety of trees, and I love being surrounded by trees.
Let's look inside.
Yes.
Come on, then.
Originally a pair of mill cottages, from the outside, the layout of this property is far from conventional. The back of the house is the oldest part, dating back to the 16th century. The extension on the front includes the kitchen, utility room and study, and was built around 15 years ago.
Now, I brought it in this way because I wanted you to see some of the sort of ancillary areas, if you like. But come to the most important room for you, Sue, first, which is, of course, the kitchen. What do we think?
It's not as big a kitchen as I would hope for. Nice touches, love the tiles over the cooker.
It's about the same size as the kitchen we already have, and you wanted something somewhat bigger, didn't you, really?
Yeah. I would like an area like this, with as much again, so that there is room for a couple of sofas and things like that. When we've looked at the rest of the house, it may be that it becomes less important.
Yes, maybe.
Really? You'd compromise? Do you feel so strongly about this? OK.
I do, but all houses are a compromise.
Yeah.
Music to my ears. Come with me. Yep.
The kitchen may have failed to cut the mustard with Sue, but I'm hoping the rest of the house will be more to her taste.
Now, I know someone's going to like this room.
OK.
Not your full-size billiard
it's
table.
It's not a full-size table. But it's a nice-sized room, isn't it?
It's a snug, isn't it?
Yeah.
Television room or a couple of sofas. It's a pleasant-sized room. It's OK.
This is the older part of the building.
Yeah, yes, that's exactly
which makes sense.
Yeah. Let's go and have a look at the main reception room, come with me.
Just off the main entrance hall is a useful dining area under a glass roof where the extension joins the original house. Leading off it is the study to one side and the sitting room directly opposite.
I rather like this room. Do you?
It's warm. It feels cosy.
It's got a nice high ceiling.
Yeah.
Plenty of light.
It's a nice room. It's a nice room.
I think your opinion is coloured already by the kitchen, isn't it, Sue?
This is a lovely room on its own, but it's not enough.
Before Sue completely dismisses this house, I want to show them the bedrooms upstairs. There are five in total, including three good-sized guest doubles looking out onto the back garden, along with a large single. There are two separate bathrooms and, of course, the master suite.
Now, I know you wanted loads of guests to come and stay, but I also think you need a bit of privacy. So, you want a master suite. So, you've got a wet room there, and then I think this would be your master bedroom.
I think this is a perfectly adequate sized bedroom.
You've obviously got a sense of what you're after a lot more, Sue.
An immediate observation is that, you know, one wants to stand and look out of a window, or you can't, you've got to kneel. Because the windows are below head height.
OK.
Do you know, there is so much to like in this house, and somebody will like it, they'll love it, but so far it's not having much appeal for me.
Sue's clearly got a vision of what her perfect property looks like, and I've got doubts as to whether this is it. However, I'm confident the garden won't disappoint. The plot of just over an acre surrounding the house includes a large lawn and even has a stream flowing through it.
Well, fairly unconventional outside space, but I think it's splendid, don't you?
I love it.
Do you?
I really do.
There is so much to like, but I'm seeing a house here and I'm seeing a house up there, which isn't really the isolation that we were looking for.
Sue, it's got a rope swing over a stream.
Yeah.
This is Pert water. Apparently it's fed by a reservoir.
Yeah, it's very pretty. It's very pretty and it's got lovely, lovely areas, really lovely areas, but I see another house right there.
You want complete isolation?
Yeah.
Right.
It's for somebody, and I think it's for somebody who has got a young family now.
Right now.
Yeah.
Yes.
How much do you think that somebody will need to pay for it?
£585,000.
OK.
It's a lovely house. It's got a lot of interest to it. The grounds are great. So I'm going to go more. I would say £625,000.
Keep going. This place is on the market for offers in the region of £695,000.
OK.
Right, I've learned quite a bit about you guys.
Yeah.
You might be prepared to give a little and take a bit.
Oh, we're not completely inflexible. We can compromise.
You've now got the opportunity to go back into the house. Go and have a look around, and I'll meet you whenever you're done, all right?
OK, thank you.
Play the troll on the way over.
I think this detached period property has loads going for it. There's one more bedroom than Steve and Sue asked for, and a large kitchen, although apparently not big enough. There are gardens of over an acre, and it's in a glorious setting in the heart of the Quantock Hills.
Oh, this is your study?
Yeah, there's the office.
And that's quite a good size for a study area.
This is a very good room.
Yes.
The garden's wonderful. If we can get a place with a garden like this, I'd be very, very happy. I was a little disappointed with actually the size of the house. The kitchen in particular didn't measure up to our hopes.
There's a lot to like. But I really feel that this house lends itself to a family with small children. It will be a happy home for somebody else, but it's not for us.
Are you happy you came here?
Oh, definitely,
goodness,
yes.
Yes,
it's
for sure.
Yeah, it's good to see, it's good to make a comparison, and it's good for you to know what it is that we're looking for more specifically.
Don't pile any more pressure on me. I already feel it.
Come on, say we. We mean you.
Somerset, along with the neighbouring county of Devon, forms one of the largest farming regions in the UK. With Sue and Steve's ambition to live the good life here in Somerset, we've sent them to meet Antonio Palladino, a chef who swapped life in London for a one-acre plot of land in the West Country to set up a modern version of a farming technique believed to date back as far as the Aztecs, aquaponics.
Welcome to the aquaponic farm.
Thank you.
What is that? What does that mean?
It's just fish farm, in this case trout. It's the integration of fish and plant into one ecosystem.
So why did you start the farm?
Well, I'm a chef, and for me, affordable quality food has always been a priority. I was on a trip to Malaysia, and I accidentally bumped into aquaponics. And as a skeptic, that got me thinking, why is not everybody doing it already? So I had to test it and try it myself first. So we started a system in London, for a year, and after that first year, we realised that, wow, that's working. Of course, London, small place, expensive. We had to move out to have a farm.
Yes.
And here we are.
Antonio has four tanks, each containing 500 trout. Fed only with organic fish food, their bi-waste provides high-quality nutrients for the plants in the polytunnels next door. The plants, in turn, act as a biofilter to keep the water in the tanks clean. Amazingly, the same water has been circulating in the system for 4.5 years.
So can you grow anything like this, or do some things lend themselves better?
You can literally grow any crops that you would be normally growing in soil, but without soil, of course, in this case. And here, you can see where it's...
Oh, my goodness.
With the root system and all the water full of nutrients coming.
So that pipe is being fed into this tank directly from
the fish tank.
What about the taste? Better? Worse? Same?
You're gonna decide. You tell me. Try some of this.
What is that?
That's French sorrel.
Oh, wow, that is so good.
Because the nutrients, it's high quality.
That is really strong, isn't it?
Mmm.
That'd be great in
That's
salad.
Really good.
That'd be
really
good in a salad.
Antonio grows a huge variety of salads and vegetables, from cannellini beans to cabbages, as well as some more unusual varieties, all harvested by hand. As the irrigation system offers the plant roots a continuous supply of water and nutrients, many of the plants grow twice as fast as they would in soil. A lettuce that would normally take 3 to 4 months to grow is produced in just 2 months.
This seems such a simple, straightforward process. Why aren't there more people doing this?
They are. They're just catching up now. It's only a matter of time before more are going to embrace it.
What are your plans for the future? Where do you go from here?
Well, frankly, this was the plan, and we achieved it, was to be able to produce for ourselves and to provide for others good quality food at affordable rates.
Yes.
And, frankly, we're happy with these sites. We don't want to...
You're living the dream, aren't
yes.
you?
I think you're there.
Brilliant.
Fantastic.
Antonio, you've got so much to do. We better leave you to
Thank you so
thing.
Much for your time. Yeah. Really enjoyed our day. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Antonio's farm is currently one of only two using aquaponics in the UK. But as people are becoming increasingly concerned with the source of their food, and the popularity of organic food steadily rising over the last few years, sustainable techniques look set to define the future of our farms. Back on the house hunt, the next property I want to show Sue and Steve is in Selworthy, on the northern fringes of Exmoor. At 308 metres high, nearby Selworthy Beacon is one of the highest points on Exmoor and offers some spectacular views. The village itself lies within the National Trust's Honeycutt Estate and is known for its perfectly preserved thatched cottages and distinctive 14th century church with whitewashed walls perched on the side of the hill.
Now, Steve, you said one of the reasons you were looking forward to living down here was the topography.
You've got it.
I think that you could call that topography.
It's amazing,
isn't it? On the spectacular end of the scale.
Yeah.
Some great walking.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, on the way up the hill here, we saw so many public footpaths, so it'd be...
Is that something you want to get into, then?
Oh, absolutely,
yes,
of course.
We do walk.
We walk a lot.
Yeah, we do. Yeah.
So you'll be pleased to hear, then, the house we want to show you is just down the road.
Oh.
We can walk there, as we shall.
Let's do it, my goodness.
On the edge of the village, our property sits in an elevated position, making the most of the views.
So we finally, after coming down and up a hill, arrive at property number 2. Come on, hit me with it. What do you think?
Nice front door.
Love the front door.
Well, that doorway leads into what was once a rectory. It's been split up since. I'm looking forward to showing you some amazing features inside here.
When you say split up, does that mean it's attached to something else?
Yes, it does.
So it's not a detached house?
It's not a detached house. This is finding out what compromises you're prepared to make. Come with me.
Not exactly the best of starts, but I think if Sue and Steve can remain open-minded, this 16th century house offers them a lot of what they're looking for. And with a floor space of nearly 440 square metres, it's around a third bigger than the first property.
So this is an entrance hall with a bit of a difference. This is a room in itself, isn't it? This is just your hallway.
My goodness, it's huge.
Now, I don't know whether you'd ever consider yourself in a room like this, but it's rather grand.
It is grand. I love that window.
You've got the nice big proportions and a working fireplace as well.
This is a very big room, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a very good size room.
Yeah.
It's very airy.
Yeah, it is, isn't it? All right, well, another room next door of similar size.
They're clearly pleasantly surprised by these large, well-proportioned spaces, but they're not won over just yet.
So, dining room. Would you consider ever having a separate dining room?
We have a separate dining room at the moment. It works. We use it a lot.
For when we have the 10 members of the family around for dinner, we can't get them all in the kitchen. It does get used.
Yeah.
So dining room's fantastic.
Yeah.
Oh, right. We didn't want to use it as a dining room.
No, no, you won't stand a chance for this. Go on.
It might take a full-size snooker table, just looking at it.
Really?
It might.
OK, look, another nice big room. Let's go on to the kitchen.
Okay.
Steve might be happy now he's spotted a potential games room, but I'm not sure I've got Sue on board. At the back of the house, there's a large utility and pantry area, giving the current kitchen some much-needed storage space.
Now, I might be ducking for cover here. Remember that room there? Remember these walls?
Yes.
Come with me. No, no. Right, come in and stand here with me.
OK.
Now, the owner, by her own admission, she walked me around the house and said, look, I know the kitchen's too small for modern houses, so we've had plans drawn up.
OK.
And the plans are to knock walls. That way, that way. I still think that would make a good-sized kitchen, but I still don't think it'd be big enough for the day room that you'd be after. You'd need to go that way, which would mean resubmitting, obviously, drawings. And the issue there I'd want to flag up is, obviously, it's Grade 2 listed.
Mm. This is probably more than we want to undertake.
Yeah. Let's go upstairs. Let me show you one of the bedrooms.
Yes.
And then we'll go outside, yeah?
OK.
Upstairs are three huge double bedrooms with lovely high ceilings, a large single bedroom and a dressing room currently used as a fifth bedroom. The two bathrooms could do with a bit of updating, but are both a fair size.
Now, as master bedrooms go, this is cracking, isn't it?
It's a good size.
Proportions-wise, these are what you're after, right?
Very much.
Yeah, the rooms are a good size. I can't fault the rooms.
And even style-wise, you like this period, you like these proportions.
Yeah, the house internally is great. Just take all the internals and put them somewhere a little more remote.
Away from other humans.
Yes.
Yeah. I can hear you metaphorically banging me over there with a stick now, saying, if you're taking me this long...
I can do it for real, if you like.
No, that'd be fine. I think I get your point.
It's a shame they've already written off this house because the gardens that come with it are a major selling point. There are lawns to both the front and south-facing rear, surrounded by a variety of well-established trees and some incredible views towards Exmoor.
A mature garden, very different to the first place we saw, but looking around us, I can tell that you'd like to be a bit more remote.
This garden is a pretty garden. It's got some beautiful mature trees. The view up there is stupendous.
Yes. Yeah, it is, isn't it?
It really is.
But I can see other people.
Now, how much do you think this house is on the market for? Not how much you'll pay for it, so.
Oh, gosh. I'm going somewhere close to 575,000.
I'm going to go higher than that. I'm going to say £625,000.
Not bad guesses. So they put an asking price of offers around £575,000 on it. So spot on, Susan.
Oh, yeah, she shoots.
Yes.
She scores.
And definitely so.
It's a lot of house for that money.
It's incredibly disappointing, actually, because if you took that house and put it in a field, then it would have so much appeal.
I think as well, whilst we're here and you've liked it so much, enjoy the garden, have a look around, enjoy the views, and I'll meet you at the front. How's that? All right?
Thank
you. See you in a moment.
This Grade 2 listed former rectory has 5 bedrooms, a number of spacious living areas, and although the kitchen isn't large, there's potential to open it up, subject to planning consent. Despite all of this and a fabulous garden to top it off, the proximity to the neighbours has put Sue and Steve right off.
The rooms are large, airy, high-ceilinged. It's got all the potential we need, but it's not isolated.
Sadly disappointing.
Beautiful views at the back, weren't they?
They really were, yes.
But you'd like views perhaps surrounding the property, or at least not views of other houses.
Truly.
Truly.
That would be better.
OK. Well, I've got a long night ahead of me tonight. Let's go.
The second day of our house hunt with Sue and Steve from London, who, now they've retired, are leaving the busy capital behind to set up home in rural Somerset. For their budget of £700,000, they're after a detached property with a sense of isolation. So far, it's been a bit of a bumpy ride. But coming up, our search gathers speed as I pull out all the stops at our mystery house.
My mind is in 8th gear, not even 5th. There's endless possibilities here.
Yeah.
And I head to the coast to unwind.
Of course she goes, all right, doesn't she, Martin? Well, I think I'm going to chalk yesterday down to experience. But moving forward, I think what Steve and Sue essentially want is a big house, a huge home. But it also needs to sit in a decent amount of land, of course it does. But for Sue in particular, she wants privacy. But in order to get this huge bundle of joy, if you like, within their budget, the compromise is we're going to need to travel. And the mystery house here is over the border. Let's see, here we go. Now, I'm treating today as a clean slate.
Yeah, so are we.
Good. We're taking a gamble today in order to try and get what we think you might want.
A gamble sounds interesting.
The gamble is you're going to have to put up with my company for even longer than anticipated.
We're travelling, that's what you mean?
We're travelling.
OK.
In an attempt to turn this search around, we're heading to Devon, where our mystery house is in the village of Witheridge. Almost equidistant from Dartmoor and Exmoor, the village has earned the nickname Gateway to the Two Moors Way, a long-distance walking route between the two national parks and the perfect starting point for exploring them. Arranged around the village square are pretty thatched cottages and the village church. There's also a tea room and a local pub. Our mystery house is right in the heart of the village, accessed by a long private driveway.
Now then, young man.
That's good.
Yeah?
Yeah, oh yeah.
This is a different Sue. I like this Sue.
This is everything that I would have drawn in a picture.
It is a bit like that, isn't it? Now, there is a compromise with this property. That house there
That's included as well.
OK.
All right, so you get more. It was built as a vicarage and moved into in 1855, right up until 1984. Then became a B&B and then a private residence.
I haven't managed to say anything yet. I'm just lost for words, really. It looks fantastic. It looks fantastic.
Two confessions. I know the village from years gone by, and I've seen this property online, but I have to say, in the flesh, it looks considerably larger.
You have got a retirement beckoning you here, haven't you? To get hold of this and make it that grand rectory it was once before.
I want to see inside.
Yeah?
I do.
Come on then, let's go.
This huge detached property has a typical Victorian layout, which I'm hoping will appeal to Sue as much as its exterior does. The ground floor has four large reception rooms and a kitchen off a central hallway, as well as a number of smaller utility rooms. The front door leads us through the entrance hall and we start our tour in a rather impressive sitting room.
OK. Like, you've done a good job on this one.
Excellent. Good, good. Big square room with tall ceilings.
And the original features, the skirtings and the floorboards.
Yeah, absolutely. No, tick, 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 tick.
You've got a big problem on your hands in as much that you've now got rooms to buy furniture for. You've got another room this size with another beautiful bay next door.
Okay.
And you've got other rooms further down the hall.
Big table, sewing room, lots of curtains to be made.
Come with me, I'll show you more.
Well, that's a relief. I'm so pleased that the supersized proportions of this mystery house aren't too daunting for them. On the way to the kitchen, there's a study, two more reception rooms, one of which is currently being used as a dining room, a staircase leading down to a large cellar, as well as a pantry and a utility room.
As it stands, here is your kitchen.
Okay.
All right, now, obviously, I know this is too small, Susan. Mm-hmm. Come with me to what would have been originally the house's kitchen. And what a kitchen it would make again.
Yes, it would.
Yes, it would. Make that the utility room and keep this as the kitchen.
Yeah?
Yeah, my mind is in eighth gear, fifth. We talked about compromises.
Yeah.
And in a house like this, you can make compromises.
Oh, okay.
There's endless possibilities here. Yeah. Absolutely loving it.
Onward and upward.
Upstairs, there's a total of six bedrooms, three of which are very large doubles, one with ensuite, along with two doubles and a single room, all with high ceilings and some great period features. The bathrooms do need some updating, but both are a good size.
Believe it or not, there are bigger bedrooms than this one, but I wanted to show you this room with this stunning view.
There's nothing beyond this property, then?
No, just farmland.
Every room is kind of jaw-droppingly wonderful.
Yeah.
You know, and obviously it needs work.
Yeah.
But it is just full of potential.
It really is.
You could really turn it into something special, couldn't you?
It's a heritage house, isn't it?
Yeah, it really
all
is.
The way through.
Yeah.
We like, don't we?
We do like.
Good. I'm glad we're enjoying this tour. Outside, I think you want to go, don't you?
We've definitely taken a chance with the location of this mystery house. It's just moments from the village centre, but you wouldn't know it. The huge gardens aren't overlooked and there isn't a neighbour in sight. It is overgrown, but it's a project and, as with the house, they could really make it their own.
It's not easy to see exactly where your boundaries are. So, if you look behind you, see those poplars?
Yes.
That's the end of the garden and it sweeps right the way round. All in all, you've got about 1¾ acres of garden.
Do you know, it feels like so much more than that.
It's private and it's a project.
And it's got trees, fabulous mature trees.
And, of course, you've got the coach house. Who knows what you could do with that?
That would take some thought, but my goodness, what a...
There is so much of everything, it's overwhelming.
What a potential that is. And actually, when you're at the back of the house here, you see what an enormous slab of a building it is.
So you've seen this property on the internet, so I'll ask Steve first. How much do you think this mystery property is on the market for?
I'd say this has got to be at the top end of our budget. I'm going to go £725,000.
Go on then, Sue, can you remember?
I do know what it is, and it is the top end of our budget. Yeah. It is £700,000.
Yeah, £699,950. So you can afford it. You can afford this. This falls within your budget.
My goodness, the space, the privacy. We're not antisocial, but we want to decide who we see and when we see them. Mm-hmm. And I think that you'd have that option here.
I know you're excited to have a look around this place on your own. Do so. Take your time, and I'll catch you whenever you're done.
Thank you.
This mystery Victorian vicarage offers Sue and Steve all the space they asked for inside and more. With 6 bedrooms, 4 large reception rooms, and the potential for Sue to create the kitchen of her dreams. We might have pushed the boundaries of their search area and taken a risk with the village location, but hopefully it's paid off.
Coming down the drive of this property, the house is substantial. Everything that we were looking for. The rooms are perfect proportions. The windows look out to spectacular views.
The mystery house is very, very close to the centre of a village. And yet, it feels, if it's in the countryside, it feels private. So it has changed our view of what would make us happy in a property.
I love it. I really, really love it.
Grinning from ear to ear.
Yeah, I am.
And I think you'd be grinning every time you came back to this house as well, wouldn't you?
I think you would.
You needed time to talk things through and perhaps discuss the practicalities of owning such a substantial asset. Mm-hmm. And we'll catch up later on, how's that?
Super.
Despite being best known for its levels, moors and meadows, Somerset has nearly 40 miles of coastline with some of the highest cliffs in England and the second longest stretch of sand in Europe, running from Burnham to Breen. I've come down to the beach at Breen to meet Martin Hale, chairman of the local land yacht club, to find out more about this exciting, environmentally friendly sport. And, wind permitting, have a go myself.
Martin, how are you doing?
How are you doing, Johnny?
Great to see you.
Okay, yeah, good.
Now, I'm thinking this weather...
Yeah.
Windy yet sunny, this is perfect for anything with a sail, right?
It's absolutely brilliant.
Now, land yachting, how did all this come about then?
Well, originally, it was the Egyptians and the Chinese. They used to use it as, like, transporting goods and people, basically.
Oh, OK.
In those days.
So when did it hit our shores, then, do you think?
About 1920, 1930, after the First World War.
Yeah.
Guys just sort of picked up bits from old sort of aircraft and...
Oh, really?
Yeah, yeah.
Just
cobbled bits together.
So talk me through the land yachts that we see today, because this looks pretty advanced.
Well, it was designed 25 years ago.
Well, to me, it looks half boat, half aeroplane, really.
Yeah, yeah, it's exactly the same as sailing.
Right.
But with 3 wheels.
A long time ago, I did have a go at this.
Yeah.
And I did really, really enjoy it.
Yeah.
It wasn't quite as blustery as this, but I would love to have a go on that looking machine.
Well, let's get the kit on then.
Come on, let's go for it.
So
how much would this be worth?
This yacht,
yeah.
About £5,500.
I promise to be careful.
It wasn't until the late 1960s that land yachting was classified as a sport. The yachts themselves have come a long way since then. Weighing just 75 kilos, they're made from a fiberglass body on a metal frame. The largest class are capable of reaching speeds up to an incredible 90 miles per hour.
Is it me, or has it got windier? I can see here, you've got me a lid.
You need one of them. You need some gloves.
Thank you very much.
Here you go.
OK, so, give me the basics.
Right, if in doubt, what we say is sheet out. Just let that go. If it starts to hike, which means this wheel's coming up off the ground, just let the sheet rope out, and it'll come back down.
Yeah. All right, in I get.
So, you lie right down, right down, right down.
You're not on it, you're in it.
Yeah.
Wait, it feels like I'm lying on the floor. What sort of speed am I likely to be doing?
Well, 30-ish.
30 is 2 inches from the ground.
Okay.
Right then.
So, gently pushing you off.
Thank you, Martin.
You'll feel the sail pulling you. And off you go.
Oh, he's off!
What's great about this sport is it's accessible to everyone, young or old, of all abilities. As long as you can steer with your foot and control the sheet rope with your hands, everyone competes on a level playing field, or beach.
She goes all right, doesn't she, Martin?
Martin took up the sport when he retired 10 years ago, and 6 months later, he was competing at his first World Championships in Belgium.
And now here we go. The wind just hit that sail. It's a good job I'm
I'm turning into the wind. Otherwise, I reckon I'd end up in Bristol. Martin, that's the best fun I've ever had without an engine. I love that sense of being slightly out of control and then fighting it back. It's fantastic. Can I just have one more spin before I go?
Absolutely.
Go on, set me off, mate.
Get ready.
Go on. Thanks, Martin. See you never.
OK.
It's been a tricky search with Sue and Steve here in Somerset. But three properties down, there's clearly only one in the running. Time to find out what they're thinking.
This search has been, well, it's been ups and downs, haven't there? It's been a journey for all of us. I wonder, do you think you've changed your mind about your desires for this isolated position? I know you're looking into the future now and the practicalities of that.
I think that privacy can replace isolation.
Yeah.
Isolation was perhaps the wrong word.
In our first chat, it was all about the kitchen. But it was actually the privacy that leapfrogged above everything else on the shopping list.
It did, which was quite revealing.
As I said, it's a journey, isn't it?
It really is. My goodness, we've had one.
And it was a journey today, because we went over the border to Devon.
Yes.
Was it worth the commute?
Oh, for sure.
So, the mystery house has come to the rescue. Sue, you seem to come alive there. That was a Sue I hadn't yet met.
Oh, I tell you, I was getting paint charts out. What we have created in our own heads already is a very continuous kitchen space. Walls coming down, keeping chimney breasts, but taking down parts of walls, and we really think that that could work very, very nicely.
Right, that sounds promising. So what's the next step then? How do you feel about the mystery property?
It's not a decision that you're going to make lightly.
If this house is meant for us,
we
will consider what we're willing to pay. But it is. It's one hell of a place, isn't it?
Look, whatever you decide, let us know, won't you?
We shall.
Yeah, thank
Certainly.
You.
It'd be a hell of a housewarming party, wouldn't it? Back to the room with a view.
Yeah, it's yours.
Good luck.
thank you.
There were times when I was reminded that Sue and Steve were indeed looking to buy their first house together. They clearly had differing opinions on what they would be prepared to compromise on. But they really came together in that mystery house and both solved the issue of whether or not they wanted isolation. They actually just needed privacy. But they still have one more conundrum to solve. In loving the mystery house, they need to understand that it comes with a huge responsibility. Not only doing up, but maintaining a period property of that size. And hopefully, they'll make that decision over the coming weeks. I'm looking forward to finding out what they say. If you'd like to escape to the country in England, Scotland, Wales or Northern Ireland and would like our help, you can apply online at bbc.co.uk/beonashow.